the treatment is often more difficult than an anger raised group because due to pre-existing osteoporosis, osteoarthritis, and rotator cuff lesions along with the various systemic comorbidities. Therefore, the treatment of functional human fractures are anger is very difficult for treating surgeons. The sites that are involved in functional human fractures are the surgical neck, ornamental neck, and both fibrosities, long impacted fractures, and forepart fractures, and fracture dislocations, and head splitting. It is very crucial to differentiate between the fractures of anatomical and surgical neck because the anatomical neck fractures, blood supply will be disrupted and the AVH is very high, whereas the surgical neck fractures, the blood supply is usually spare. The study on 24 fresh frozen cadaver shoulders reveals that 64% of the blood supply to the humeral head was supplied with posterior circumflex humeral heart rate. So what is the optimal management for dispersed functional fractures? Is there still controversy? Cooperate or conservative? A study about 231 patients, 114 in surgical group and 117 in non-surgical group, this reveals there was no significant difference between surgical treatment and compared to the non-surgical treatment. The another paper also reveals that no convincing benefit of surgical treatment over non-surgical treatment for dispersed fractures of functional fractures. But the rest of the 15 or 20% of fractures needs surgery. So there are so many different types of surgeries that are offered for the fractures for functional humerus which are displaced and bundle fractures. The plate screw construct is very good for fixation. It provides most stable fixation but requires extensive exposure for plate application. Carries risk of damage to the neurovascular sectors. Most frequent complications, infection and osteonecrosis of humerus. We have to admit that there is a problem with current methods of implant fixation, including long implant. You can see those pictures that the losing of implant and the non-unions and the AVN and all. So, R.S. Cofield wants very early and use adequate radiograms to understand the fracture pattern. That's very important. Use a safe and simple surgical approach. Know the options for implant fixation. The radiograph evaluation you have to take both AP and latitudes and the superaxial view. And for more details, you have to go for CT scan with the 2mm sections is indicated. This is very important. Must have lateral view always or CD to ever better about the other fractures that you lost to. So, minimally invasive procedures are why? Why you should go for this minimally invasive? There are so many advantages. Minimal dissection and less of soft tissue drama. No vascular disruption, no vascular necrosis, more chance of for fracture union, less chance for infection, no much post-operative shoulder stiffness, no much blood loss, no post-operative ugly scar. The limited tissue dissection allows minimizing the incidence of non-union vascular necrosis and infection. So reduces the chance of unnecessary prosthetic replacement. So what is the goal of surgery? So our goal is restoration of functional humeral anatomy, stable fixation and good functional range of motion. So, first thing, there are about five methods I am going to explain. One is WIPO. This very commonly we do in our regular practice. The main advantage of this approach consists in the direct access with the great fibrosity, thus facilitating its anatomic reduction and fixation. Allows respecting vascular and soft tissue around the fracture, thus preserving better conditions for bone healing. So this is dentoid splitting approach just now, Krishnan explained about this. In this also we can do the better fixation of the functional humeral fractures with a minimal invasion, minimal incision size. So here the plate should be seated just lateral to the bicipital groove kept in contact with the bone. The superior plate should be 1 cm below the crack capacity, provides
light.
So that should be the fixation. The next procedure is the wheel and ball really showed that the biomechanical stability is far less than the pin fixation. So this is the approach where you can open a very small incision and you can make a hole in that tuberosity and then you can insert the nail. And one thing is you have to use the threaded pins as a jaw shape in posterior human head to derotate the humerus for the fixation for the reduction and then put the navigated nail and insert the nail. So that is the fixation.
Oh,
so this is very bad fracture, partial fracture can be fixed nicely with the nail. But problem is insertion of interlock nail into the humerus violates retinal cuff, which can lead to post-operative shoulder pain. So there is another technique, which is minimally invasive treatment of the severe partial fractures by a humerus block device in the candidate self-tap discus. So this is a very technique of in this, we use this small device where the two KOAs will be inserted retrogradually from the shaft into the metaphysis into the haggard humerus with the angle of 30 degrees. So, this crystal has surface in the humerus block to prevent their migration. This maintenance reduction and avoid painful soft tissue irritation. The fixation of the crossed crystal vase in the humerus block and cortex as well as the subcondral bone layer provides excellent stability against rotation and lateral displacement. This makes it possible to maintain reduction even in osteoporotic bone. So there will not be any migration of the KOAs. But here the humerus block is preventing the lower migration of the KOA and we are fixing that block with a vertical screw to the shaft of the humerus. So here we are putting this KOAs about 35 degrees angle from the shaft of the humerus. And the two KOAs are going directly towards the head of the humerus, making about 24 degrees angle. So, humerus block surgical techniques, humerus block is remote from the fracture site, it does not impair the blood supply to the head of the humerus. This reduces the risk of necrosis and promotes rapid healing. You can see the post-operative picture and the AP and the axial view, and you can see that. After 16 weeks, you can see the very good union of the fracture. So one more minimally invasive procedure is the external fixation by Joshi external fixation system. This some people, it depends on the surgeon's confidence and experience. They can select the minimally invasive procedures to preserve the vascularity to the fragments of the head of the humerus. So this is also one of the good techniques. You can see the post-operative pictures of this external Joshi's surveillance system. This is the mini post-operative and you can see the 8 weeks, 6 weeks post-op. And then the last one is previous post-op. You can see the complete union without any AVN changes. The last one I want to propose is the percutaneous spinning. This is the regularly we do in our practice. There is no scalpel, you don't use an incision for this. Can be done under intraskelly regional anesthesia. Important to get bicorporeal fixation is very important so that there will not be because the there will not be any purchase in the intermedullary canal of humerus. So important to threshold height inclination and retroversion humerus. That means the three important factors to be maintained whenever you do this. Not only this, anyone, any fixation of humerus. So I will show you some of here post-op pictures what we have done here. So we have one case almost under fracture, we have fixed like that, what we did. Unfortunately, I could not provide the clinical pictures. So this is the fracture dislocation of the humerus. And I put a small incision at the metaphysical groove and partially covered up the process and pulled the head of the humerus and then keep it into denied and fix the lateral part to the KOAs. This is another case in the old days where we used to push these rust nails from anti-grade and from below we put the KOAs. This also same situation, this very bad practice still is not a good result with this. Another time board, we will fix this fracture with the free of, it is not available, but we have a very bad fracture, but we could fix with the multiple KOAs and got good results.
It's not very good situation to pursue with that advantages. We don't leave this cave just alone, but we leave them with U-slab also. We mobilize for 1 month or 4 weeks, then we start mobilizing that. So this is another case of you can see that the tissue on the possible the caves are removed and the fractures are well united, exactly removed. So this gentleman is falling from a running bike 3 years ago. We offered to get a fracture right across the and we fixed it with the KYS of the close reduction. These are very recent photographs about 5 years back. Now he is inland. He sent it from London where he is residing. So he is doing well. And this is a very bad fracture where the capital epiphyse of the humerus was not displaced. And we fixed it with KYS. This is a work very long back. We did this fracture problem humerus. We just put the KY because fracture was eliminated. So this lady, old lady, had a fracture and we fixed the KYS as well as approximately I pushed this to tens, titanium elastic tens I pushed and then it was also doing well. The post of Victor United. This is done recently 2 months ago and KYS and all KYS, both adequate and moderate, we also do that. The take-home message is, we are treating functional humeral fractures in elderly patients. Remember, pre-existing osteoporosis, osteoarthritis and rotator lesions along with various comorbidities. Important to restore the height, inclination and retroversion of the humeral head. And your goal should be restoration of functional humeral anatomy, stable fixation, and good functional range of motion. Moreover, the humerus is a non-weight bearing joint, shoulder joint. That's why a little malunion you can accept instead of opening widely and putting a wide big plate and enjoying the post-op to good picture and all. But after that, patient may have definite problems. So with this, thank you all. Thank you.